So the GitHub Universe keynote surfaced on my YouTube page, and apparently Emacs did not make the cut for your favorite editor. I mean, VS Code and Visual Studio, I understand. It's just good business sense to list your own product offerings before others. But Vim gets a spot on the podium and not Emacs? Dude, that's cold. Not for nothing, but hey, GitHub. I know the GNU organization took a dump on Copilot. Something about ethics and copyright infringement, I'm not sure what it was. But commercial Emacs is more than willing to play ball. I just need you guys to send me the API, the IP address of a Copilot test instance, and if you could throw in a new laptop, that'd really speed up development. My 11-year-old ThinkPad is getting a bit long in the tooth. I posted a video on my fix for long lines in June. No more than 2 weeks later, someone posted a patch to the mailing list, claiming to have also fixed long lines, which made me think of Roger Bannister and the cracking of the 4-minute mile. Once you show it can be done, it convinces the field to all try in earnest. His fix was to employ a device well known to Emacs users called narrow region. I'll demonstrate. I highlight a region, say this function compose text. Then I type meta x narrow region. Now, even though I've done nothing to the file on disk, the buffer, for all intents and purposes, becomes just that region. Any operation on the buffer only sees what's on the screen. So if I do a search and replace, it's limited to this function. It's a nifty proof that Emacs successfully separated the view from the model and the controller. But it's not all that practically useful, since most commands, like replace string, already take into account an actively marked region without having to narrow first. But it's in the narrowing trick that the long lines fixer found salvation. Broham identified all the places where display code insisted on iterating from the line start. If the line start is 1 million characters back, well, that's how far back we're going to go. So, in all those places, Broseph applied the narrowing trick to cap how far to go back. Now, you'd think it'd be better to figure out why the code insisted on going back that far in the first place, and then try convincing it not to do that. But that's not how Emacs development works. Once something is done a certain number of years, it cannot be undone. The ball of mud can only be added to, never subtracted from. Well, narrowing was a familiar concept to the mailing list, and they were more than ready to crown a giant slayer. The cheering reminded me of Chris Rock's quip about recidivists who proudly claim that they take care of their kids, who, to paraphrase Chris Rock, boast about doing things that a normal person just does. Well, Emacs is like that, a paroled convict who pats himself on the back for things that normal text editors just assumed were basic requirements. You don't have to be an Emacs expert to see that just lopping off data whenever it's convenient might get you into trouble. It did not take long for the developers to recognize the hack, and I mean that literally. The narrowing trick actually hacks off the front of the line. The most obvious failure mode is a line consisting of an enormous string constant, the opening quote of which is more than 10,000 characters away from the closing quote. Since Emacs can't see the lopped-off opening quote, it can't know that it's a string, and the coloring shows. At some point, the string loses its coloring. If some other syntax-sensitive routine in the display engine needs to know that it's a string, well, it won't. Other complaints began surfacing, like how the coerced narrowing could conflict with deliberate user hooks that assumed unnarrowed buffers. The narrowing also produces unsettling navigational artifacts. So, if you go up and down a screen line, you ought to remain at the same column. Here, I'm just hitting Control N, then Control P. However, once you hit a long line, the column becomes unstable. Here I am at the left edge of your screen, and now I Control N. At some point, it will jump to the right side of the screen, and then proceed in staircase fashion with each Control N. But the maintainers held fast to narrowing. For too long, Emacs endured the ignominy of long lines, and they reassured each other that perfect cannot be the enemy of the good, nor should severely imperfect stand in the way either. But lest we get ahead of ourselves, the performance, regardless of the tactics it took to achieve, remains underwhelming. I mean, here I am attempting to navigate a widely used, minified JavaScript file, and it locks up pretty quick. I'll have to wait for the screen to refresh. My CPU fan is spinning hard. Okay, it woke up. Let me try again. Almost an immediate lockup. Now, I will say that in previous versions of Emacs, the whole program would just stop and there was no turning back. You would have to kill it externally. Now, at least, you have the option of waiting. Now, I wrote a fairly brain-dead benchmark navigating 1 million characters spread over 12,500 screen lines. A transcript of that benchmark script is in the description below. Now, I was told this kind of contrived benchmarking was irrelevant because it did not reflect, and I quote, actual usage patterns. I get it. People see what they want to see, which is why they also won't see this telling statistic, that find file literally accounts for a six-fold speedup over normal find file. What is it about normal find file that makes everything so much slower? We'll find out in a minute, but permit me to finish the story. In June, I was content to do what Vim and VS Code do, which is to douse syntax highlighting and other niceties in the presence of long lines, the rationale being files that contain them were likely log files, not source files. This seemingly unambitious goal still took me nearly 6 weeks to finish, although most of that was rewriting the display engine to some semblance of sanity. The GNU people immediately put my solution in scare quotes, saying foregoing highlighting wasn't a nuanced enough answer, which is odd given how famously unnuanced Emacs code often is. So a week ago, I got back on the unemployment horse and went at it. Actually, I did not need to get back on, if I'm really being honest. I don't choose to ride the unemployment horse, it rides me. This video is already 5 minutes too long, so I'll dispense with the backstory. What I'm about to describe will only make sense to experienced Emacs developers. What's still killing GNU Emacs' performance is always-on bidirectional processing, henceforth I'll call BiDi, and a botched rewrite of Kenichi Honda's find automatic composition function that does multi-byte glyph processing. The latter was fairly straightforward to fix. That got me about a third of the way. The real killer is BiDi and the function getVisuallyFirstElement. Now, I suppose I could fix it the same way I fixed find automatic composition, but I did Emacs one better and made BiDi strictly an on-demand thing. And by on-demand, I don't mean a janky BiDi minor mode. I mean the BiDi infrastructure only activates when the engine detects a BiDi character. Now, I understand BiDi is a source of personal validation for the Emacs maintainer, but his enmeshing it with the display code in 2010 was akin to a master's student forcing the entire engineering department to read his thesis on languages of the Levant. This is why my solution will probably never fly for GNU. A gatekeeper will always insist on control going through functions he authored, even if those functions are only relevant 1% of the time, a no-op 98% of the time, and in the remaining percent brings Emacs to a halt. And finally, getting to the point, quick demo of commercial Emacs on long lines. We'll use bootstrap.min.js, a widely used minified JavaScript file. Unlike in June, Emacs no longer apologizes and sustains syntax highlighting and multi-byte characters. Here, we'll drop in some Hindi. This was not possible in June when long lines was unibyte only. We'll go to the bottom of the file and traverse backwards, which in the past has been notoriously slow. And we'll see that we can go back and sustain a repeated key press. We'll also note that the column is stable under commercial. The speed may not be as zippy as Vim or VS Code, but realize for those two editors, they douse syntax highlighting in the presence of long lines. Okay, let's check the benchmark. Okay, and under find file, the version of find file that sustains multibytes and syntax highlighting, we'll see a 10-fold speed up over GNU.